something which I've signed myself up for testing. So, ladies and gentlemen, please give a very warm welcome to Stefan and Katrin.
Hi everybody, I'm super happy to be here today, and yes, I can make the best Apfelstrudel in the world, thanks for the intro. After this amazing keynote and kicking off this nice conference, it's now our turn. And we will talk about automating UI development. My name is Katrin, and I work as a web developer and also as a UX designer at Dynatrace in Austria. And I'm also one of the organizers of DevOneConf. And today, I'm here together with my colleague, mentor, and friend, Stefan.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm Stefan. I'm Dead Parrot on Twitter. And I have a little side project called JavaScript Podcast. It's on javascriptpodcast.com. And it's a podcast about JavaScript. If you like, please check it out. Let me know what you think. We feature interviews and conference talks and beer garden chats. So I guess there's something in there for everybody. And let me know what you think. And like Katrin said, we work at Dynatrace. And I want to spend just a few words about Dynatrace so that you know where we are coming from and which challenges we face and which things brought us to what we are going to show you today. And Dynatrace is in software intelligence. So we create an application performance monitoring tool. And we monitor your full stack, so end-to-end visibility. Be it your main stack running in your Docker container, on your Kubernetes cluster, in your most favorite cloud provider, if that's a thing. We know what's going on in there, and we can give you invisibility. And as you have seen from the product screens, there's lots of stuff going on. So it's lots of different screens focusing on different problems and on different problem domains. And that's how we organize ourselves as well. So we're working in different expert groups. And each expert group is focusing on one particular problem domain. And we are talking here about more than 600 developers, designers, and product managers working together on a single product, which also means on a single product UI. And you can think of that as having the most specialized and most fitting solution for the current problem domain that you are currently looking on. And with all those different expert groups and all the things that are going on here, you can think of our whole UI as being highly specialized screens fitting for the problem you're looking at with lots of generic and very flexible components.
And as you all probably know, good UX design means also consistency. And therefore, we are using core UI components, for example, buttons and cards and tiles. And we maintain these core UI components in an Angular components library. So this is one of the examples, a screen that we are currently working on, the Cloud Foundry screen. And as our UX designers work on this screen, they may come to the point where one of the core components does not really fit their design. And therefore, and for the purpose of this presentation, we are going to update the button design. So the first step in this process is to talk to the other designers and developers of the team. Our design team at Dynatrace works cross-lab and also from all over the world, which means they have to discuss all the possibilities for a new button design, and they have to make sure that a new proposal fits the product, but also all other UI components. So in the end, they decide with which version we will move on. And the next step is to update all mockups that are currently in the queue and where they are currently working on. Our design team works with a tool that is called Sketch. And Sketch is a software to create mockups and UX designs. The cool thing about Sketch is that it uses the symbols library underneath. And the symbols library holds all our UI components and everything that can and should be reused in a UI. You could think of it like the Angular components library, but instead of code, it just holds the visual representation of the components. And with these symbols, it's much easier for us to make sure that our mockups and afterwards our product has this consistent look and feel. We store the library in Git, so therefore all our designers are always up to date with the latest design changes. And we also have the symbols library as a basis for our design system. Our design system is called Barista, because we love coffee. And it holds all the resources for our colleagues. Of course, also the UI components, the core components, all the definitions, use cases, and documentation. About all the variants of a button, for example, a secondary button, primary, or icon button, and also interactive demos and API documentation. This is a very important and powerful tool for us because it helps us to keep design teams and development teams in sync. And therefore, it's crucial that the design system is always up to date with the latest design. So now it would be time for some code. But wait a second. At this point of the process, and that's also the problem with it, we have no idea how this design change might affect the rest of the product. Because in the end, there is not only the Cloud Foundry screen. As Stefan told you before and showed you the other screens and use cases of the Dynatrace platform, and we have no idea how this will be affected by our code change. But as we move on and changing the code in our Angular library, this will affect the product and therefore the whole Dynatrace platform. To sum our process up, from the initial idea, we kicked off the whole design process. And we updated all designers with our Sketch Symbols library. And then we got to the code part. We updated our Angular library and therefore also the product code. Both the Angular Components library as well as the Sketch Symbols library come together to the Barista design system. And now it's time for the challenges with this process and why we changed it. So as you probably all know, sometimes designs don't work out as they were planned to. So you have to go back. And maybe you even have to go back to the initial idea. And if you're lucky, you can continue coding. But sometimes this just takes too long, and PM goes directly to the dev team. And yes, there are these special ideas which go nowhere. So this is a broken process, as you can see. This is a waterfall organized in sprints. And each and every of these steps could and will take a whole sprint. So we have to change this, because this is slow, cumbersome, and frustrating for everybody. Most importantly, our design and dev teams are never in sync. They live in completely different worlds. So now that we know we want to change something, we had this idea of taking the thing at the very end, our Angular Components library, and put it in the center of everything. So then now when we change, for example, our button color, together with our designers, we can have this change immediately in our design system and also in the product code. From there, we could then update our designers. So that's the big question, and that's the basis of our project we are presenting today. How could we possibly get these code changes automatically to our designs and to our mockups? We could therefore use the Sketch library. As you remember, the library is the basis of our mockups and of our designs.
So yeah, so how do we get to an automatically generated Sketch library? And just like Katrin said, we're putting the very end and are focusing on that right now. So let's see what do we need to create a Sketch library, a Sketch symbol library, and find our way back to the Angular component library. And I don't know if you know it, but Sketch is merely a bunch of JSON files. So you can unzip that, and you look at a couple of JSON files. They are huge. They take several megabytes, blowing up your editor. But hey, if it's JSON, you know what that means. If you're a developer like me and your development sense is tingling, it means that we can hack that. And that's actually what we do. So what we are looking for is CSS equivalents for Sketch JSON. And let's take the button example again, because buttons are very easy to reason about. But make it even simpler. And let's remove the text. Let's just look at the button without any text, a blue rectangle. And for Sketch, elements are organized in groups. And those groups span a frame, like in this example. The frame has the exact same dimensions as the CSS that is representative of that. So in that regard, it's a width of 122 pixel and a height of 32 pixel. But with the frame alone, we don't have any shape yet. It's just a canvas where we can draw upon. What creates a shape then is, a layer with a shape path. So instead of drawing a rectangle there, we are creating a shape path that spans a rectangle, and it spans the coordinates 0, 0 to 1.1. Now we have the shape. To make it visible, we need to apply a fill color. And the fill color also is directly translatable from the background color in CSS. So yeah, this is a very simplified version of what a simple rectangle could look like. The truth is a little bit more verbose. It looks something like this. Yeah, so that's quite a lot. But truth be told, there's not just CSS properties that we translate. There's also lots of properties in there that are specific to Sketch, like is this layer locked or can it be transformed? There's also some metadata in there, like which artboard is it on, which page is it on, all things that we don't have in CSS, but we need for Sketch anyway. But hey, those are default values. We can just apply that. Speaking of properties, those are the properties that we are able to parse next to width and height. And we can bucket them in four different groups. One group would be shapes, so everything that is respective to width, height, shadows, and borders, and also border radius. You can translate them to corner radius in Sketch. This is the first bucket. The second bucket is all about colors, so fill colors for SVG, background colors for normal CSS and HTML elements. We can translate them as well. The third group is all about fonts. Font family, letter spacing, font size, everything that, we can translate that also. And the last one is all about visibility, being entirely visible, entirely invisible, something in between. That's also something that we can translate. And for all those properties, we also feature default values. And you can think of those default values as some sort of browser style sheet. So in the browser, when you're writing CSS, you just write the properties that are different from what the browser provides you already. And we are doing the same thing here with Sketch. If we need a certain rule, or if a shape or a group needs a certain rule, and we can find that in our CSS declaration, we get it from there, combine those two things, and can create the shape. So yeah, the first thing is done. From every element and with every CSS declaration, we can create groups and respective Sketch files. But that's not all. So now we know if we have a bunch of CSS declarations, we can generate JSON out of it. The cool thing here is that this is fully automated. We don't need Sketch for that, like some other solutions do. So we can run that in our CI and do that with every commit to master. The question is now, how do we get to those CSS declaration files? And for that, we wrote two more tools. One is a component demo application, which shows a single component after another. So just one component, which you can look at and which we can parse, and then the next one. And those components have a direct reference to our Angular component library. So those are the Angular components that we create. The other thing is a CSS scraper. And the CSS scraper does one thing. It injects a little JavaScript, an agent, into this web application. And this works with any web application. It just works particularly well with our web application. But in theory and in practice, it works with every web application. This agent has one particular task. it traverses a DOM element by element and calls two functions. First, it calls getComputedStyle. And getComputedStyle gives us all the necessary CSS properties without looking at the cascade or inheritance. So cascade and inheritance are applied to those properties, and you get everything that is applied to this particular element. Sketch doesn't have the cascade, Sketch doesn't have inheritance, so we can't translate it. We need everything that is at this particular element at this particular time. And we're also calling get bounding client rect. And this gives us all the information about dimensions, width, height, position, and we need that to form that frame and position it in our canvas. And we're doing the same thing also for nested elements. So if we have, for example, a wrapping element, a wrapping div, we call the same two methods because, you know, no inheritance, no cascade, not knowing where the properties come from, might be nested groups. So we take this and parse that as well, and also nested elements, which also means that you can have nested groups in Sketch. So this works as well. We take all that information and send it back to the CSS scraper. And the CSS scraper stores everything for us. Now, I told you that this particular app is special because we look at every component after another, every component in detail without any distractions. So what the CSS scraper has another big task, and it is to tell the app to update to the next component. So in the next step, the CSS scraper calls update. The application removes the old component, loads in the new, and the whole thing starts again. OK, we're getting there. Now we have a component app, and we run it through the CSS scraper. We get CSS declarations, run it through the sketch generator. We are almost there, but we are not yet at our Angular component library. We still need something to fully automate that. Of course, we could provide this component app ourselves. We could manually code it. But you know what happens if somebody has to do something manually? It never happens in the future again. So we want to generate this app as well. And finally, we're here with our Angular component library. And our Angular component library, probably much like yours, is written in TypeScript. And TypeScript has a very good feature that is very crucial for us. TypeScript has an API where we can look at the code that's being parsed, and we can fetch things out of that. And we are doing that with all the decorators that give us meta information about all the components that we are looking at. So the first thing that we do is we run the Angular component library through TypeScript, and we create an abstract syntax tree out of that. And this abstract syntax tree contains all the decorator information, all the meta information. And from that, we need to get two things, a pure example and all the variants of a component. So what do I mean with that? Let's look at the example first. A pure example for a button, for example, might look something like this. It's the simplest and most easy form that a component can take. So there's no distractions, no variants applied, no properties applied, also no event handlers, just this little bit of markup, put it in your app, and you have a simple button. And through the abstract syntax tree, we're looking at the template. So we're fetching this basic template. Next, we want to get all variants of this component. And for that, we look at the component itself. And the component, this is a very much simplified version of a button, has input decorators. And the input decorators provide us with the API for that component. So this is our way to change something in the component, to get something for that. In that case, the property is called variant, our API is called variant, and through TypeScript, we also know which values it can take. In that case, primary and secondary. We need one more thing from that component, and that is the selector. And with that selector, we are able to match everything we have in the pure example with what we have in the component. And that's how we can apply all those properties, all those variants, to the pure example and generate all those pages. So in the next step, we take everything, combine it, and generate simple pages with just one component at a time. We do that for every component and generate this Angular application, this Angular component application that we run in our CI. And there we are. We made the full journey from the Sketch library, from the Sketch symbol library, to the Angular component library. And the cool thing is, again, we can fully automate that. So let's go back to Katrin's example, where we made a change in a button and we made a blue color for our previously green button. Once this commit happens in Mars in our component library, CI kicks off, and the new code is sent to the app generator. The app generator then creates this component app. the CSS scraper injects an agent into this component app and downloads all the CSS information that it can find for every component and every component variant. We send a bunch of CSS declaration files to the sketch generator. The sketch generator does its magic and a new sketch library is born. And that's how it looks in action. So this is a small demo that we recorded. We can start it. Now we are generating the application. The application takes a little time to boot up. Just a little time. And this is where the fun begins. So this is my most favorite part. In debug mode, you can see a Chrome. And we have a ton of icons, apparently.
Around 700.
660? Something like that. So we are getting to real components as well. It takes some time, but we are fetching CSS for every component. By the way, we can also do SVG, so just on a side note. Then we generate those sketch files, and here we are. That's our sketch library, our sketch symbol library. Those are all the icons I was telling you about. Those are all the button variants. We have a couple of them. And the cool thing is, you know that you can take Angular components inside your Angular components, and we can do the same thing here in Sketch. So we have sketch symbols inside sketch symbols, and here we are changing the color to yellow, much to the frightened faces of our designers, I guess.
Horrible.
So, yeah, that's the tool.
That's amazing, right? I mean, that's pretty cool. And let's have a look what this really means for our process. So we came from this ugly, cumbersome, and slow process to something really cool and super nice. We have this change that now we have a single source of truth that lives in code. And our development and design teams are now 100% aligned and in sync, and this automatically. Even the names of the components are the same because they are generated from the component library. But this also means that we can now verify any design changes, core design changes, immediately and across the whole Dynatrace platform. No more handovers from sprint to sprint, from development to design, back and forth. And we got new contributors, because now our designers can update their sketch files with code. We also have all these code updates immediately visible in our design system, Barista. And all of this brings me to the question, if we can use this with every web page and every application, and we can generate our symbols, is there more?
Yes. There is a little bit more. So. We have this workflow where a designer creates a full page screen mock at some point in time so that you get a feel how the page looks like, which component it has, and this is the initial goal for having it in the product. From time to time, our designers have to make an iteration on that particular page, half a year later, several months later, and you know, during that time, everything that happens in the product evolves much, much faster. And you would always have to start anew with your mocks because they are outdated very, very fast. But with the technology that we have, with the agent that we can inject into any web page that there is, and with the information that we have from our Angular components, which translate directly into sketch symbols, we are working on a prototype that does the following. It's a small Chrome extension that injects the CSS agent and sends all the data to our servers and creates a sketch file to download. And once we open that, wait for it, we have the exact same page, and also with the DOM structure intact. And this also means that we have information about all the symbols we are using in our symbol library, and designers can start from that for the next iteration. So I think this is pretty amazing. And speaking of amazing, there's a person in the audience today, Lukas Holzer, who is the creative mind behind all that. He actually worked his ass off in the last 6 months to get to all of that. And Lukas is here in the audience today. And please have a round of applause for Lukas because he did such a great job. All right.
Yeah, that brings us to the end of this presentation. If you have any questions, don't be shy. Come to us in the office hours or reach out on Twitter, whatever fits you best. And it was a pleasure to be here. Thanks for having us.
Thank you.